Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Yeah, so it's my pleasure to welcome you all, Ravani, to Microsoft Research. You all is a professor of computer science at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. He has done seminal work on algorithms, approximation algorithms, online algorithms, and many other things. And so, yeah, it's he's been here all week. He'll be here all of next week. It's always great to have him here. And he'll tell us about learning, so how to learn mixtures of arbitrary distributions over large discrete domains. So over to you all.
Thank you. So yes, the title is almost as long as the talk. I'll be talking about joint work with Leonard, Schulman, and Swamy. Most of which was done quite a few years ago when both Swamy and I were visiting Caltech. Okay, so I want to start with some motivation for this problem, and this both the motivation and the problem itself arose in two different research communities. So one is our wonderful theory community, and more or less in parallel, people in the machine learning community suggested similar problems. The problem is to understand the structure of a corpus of documents. And for the purpose of this talk, we can think of documents just as being bags of words. So we're not really interested in higher level grammar, just which words appear in the document. Perhaps also the frequency of these words matters. And of course, if you really want to deal with documents, you have to normalize the words and remove all sorts of irrelevant stuff, such as prepositions and other uninteresting words. So I'm not going into how people actually deal with documents, mostly because I have no idea what they do. But we will think of documents as being these bags of words. We also have some model that how these documents are generated. So it's a very simple model. Of course, most people don't generate documents this way, but that's how we think of them as being generated. So in order to generate a D-word document, we have some distribution P over words, and we sample from this distribution independently D times. So that's the way we generate documents. Now, we think of these documents as being generated in the context of various topics. And we will assume that we have a relatively small number of different topics. We'll denote the number of topics by K. So in fact, if we look at the entire corpus of documents, each document in the pure documents model that I'm presenting now is generated from one of these K topics. Each topic is defined by its own distribution over words. So basically, documents from different topics differ in the distribution that is generating them. We have to assume something about the separation between these distributions, and I'll get to that. So we have these K distributions, P1 through PK. And in order to generate a new document, what we do is, first of all, we choose a topic for that document. Topic I is chosen with probability WI. Now that we've chosen a topic I, we generate the document itself by choosing words independently from the distribution PI. So that's the entire model. And you may argue that perhaps the documents that you're familiar with are not are generated or not generated this way. Papers, for example. I'm sorry?
D is not random. The size of the document is not random.
We will think of D as being fixed, but in general, you could think of different documents as having different lengths as well. And maybe that's also chosen at random, but we will actually consider fixed D. I'll get to that. Now, here's another situation where a very similar phenomenon or a very similar setting could be served as a simple model of what's happening. We have various customers. So now, instead of documents, we have customers. And we're collecting purchase history of these customers. And we can think of each customer as, this may be a bit more realistic. So you go shopping and you have your distribution P over the possible things you want to buy. And you just sample from this distribution a number, say D independent samples. And that's what you buy. For example, in the supermarket on that day. And again, in the pure model here, customers fall. So in general, when you think of these things, you assume that people are very simple and their behavior can be summarized by simple statistics. So here it's a very simple assumption. There are K types of people. And when someone arrives, say, in the grocery store, that person has type I with probability WI, and then whatever this person is going to purchase is determined by the probability PI, which is chosen according to the distribution W. Okay, so that gives us essentially the same data as documents, because we don't care if our items are words or groceries. But more generally, this model is a very simple model for various data mining applications, or it's a model of how the data is generated for various data mining applications. Including things like document features that we just talked about, customer taste. You can think of, this is sort of a outdated application when web pages used to have hyperlinks. Now they don't, right? Because you can get to any web page using a search engine, so you don't need to link them, really. The links are, I don't know, they generate Java code that does something, but they're not really links. So back when web pages had real links, you could think of these hyperlinks as being generated through the same process. And you can think of various observational studies. So suppose you're studying, I don't know, patients or whatever, you encounter a specimen, and all you can do, since the person is not really cooperating with you, maybe it's a bird in nature. They're not providing you, they're not filling up a detailed questionnaire. You can observe this thing for a little while and gather just a few attributes of the specimen that you're observing. And let's say those attributes are generated from the distribution that defines the species of this thing. So various observational studies could be modeled this way. And the general properties that under which we want to think of this model are the following. So every specimen has a large number of possible features. So there's a huge number of words, for example, in almost any language that I'm aware of. And each specimen, so if you look at a specific document, it usually doesn't contain the entire dictionary. It contains only a subset. So the documents are relatively short. Think of the specific thing to think about is for example, Twitter tweets, right? Those are very short documents. So those are the things we want to focus on. So there's only a very small sample of the distribution that generates this document. And that's, of course, a bad thing because we don't get any good statistic on that distribution from any individual document. But on the other hand, we want to assume that the population overall behaves very nicely. It falls, for example, into these K different categories that are well specified. So this is the kind of setting that we want to be interested in. And now you can think of various, right? So this is a model that generates data, and now you can think of doing all sorts of things with the data, like, I don't know, ignore it, for example, would be my first inclination. But then you want to generate a paper as well, so you need to do something rather than ignoring the documents. So the goal that we will talk about here is we actually want to infer from the documents the topic distributions. So we want to learn the topics. We don't want to classify the that would be perhaps a different objective, is to classify the documents into topics. So we don't want to classify the documents. We just want to learn these distributions P1 through PK. This is what I will call learning the mixture model, because this is really a mixture model. We have K different distributions, and our documents are generated from this mixture of distributions. So I'll define now the problem more precisely. We have a known dictionary, and without loss of generality, this dictionary will be the numbers 1 through N that represent the N different words in the language. We have as input M samples of D tuples from in fact, it's with repetition, right? So we have M samples of these words.
So relating to your previous slide, should you think of D as much smaller than N?
D is much smaller than N, yes. Yes, in fact, N will be very large. And so think exactly of this analogy. Think of the dictionary of, say, English and tweets in Twitter. I don't know how many words they have, but not many words. I guess in German they have fewer words, right? Because the words are longer. So they have bigger problems in learning things.
I don't know. This is important, but are you allowing repetition in the sample?
Yes, of course. I mean, yes, the same word could appear many times and could appear D times in the document. We're sampling independently, so in general you could have... now, how is the sample generated? So each sample, each one of these M samples is generated by picking a number J between 1 and K with probability WJ. The J's are, so here it's important to understand, these J's are independent and identically distributed, but they're hidden from the observer of the data. So we don't know which J was chosen. And then we draw D items independently and identically from the distribution PJ. And that's how a single sample here is generated. So the next sample would be independent from this. Our goal is to learn the model. The model means the mixture constituents, the P1 through PK, and their mixture weights, W1 through WK.
Have large support size, right?
Yes, each PJ has support size N. And we're seeing a very small sample of it.
You care about the sample complexity M or also?
We care about everything, so I'll soon mention what exactly we care about, but we care about all these parameters.
Do we know K?
We can assume that we know K, yes. So we will learn these things under the assumption that K is known.
We can just repeat it for different K.
Yeah. You could do that, yes, and then you would learn different things. Yes, but we will assume that we know K. Since the whole model is unrealistic and our algorithms have perhaps prohibitive constants, then why not assume that you know K? That's the least of your problems here. So I'll also denote, obviously, this can't always be achieved, right? Because there could be some tiny probability that the sample that I get is completely unrepresentative of these distributions and weights. It's something way off the charts. So I will have to allow a failure probability, which we will denote by delta. And from now on, we're going to assume that it's just some small constant. Even though most of the stuff that I'm going to tell you, you can control this constant and drive it to be as small as you like. But I'm just going to ignore it. So there's some small constant probability of failure. I don't know, 0.01, yes.
What is a failure?
The failure is that you failed to generate a model that is correct within... I'll specify what do I mean by a correct model. Obviously, you're not going to get exactly these P's and not exactly these W's.
So does the algorithm know when it is incorrect? Does it say, I'm sorry?
No, how would it know? So suppose your data, for example, let's say for some reason, each of these probabilities has some other word that has tiny, tiny probability, but for some reason, all of your documents focus somehow chose only this word. So it appears D times. I mean, once you choose one of the P's, that this tiny probability word just appears there D times. This could happen with tiny probability for exponentially small probability. What would you do then? I mean, then basically your distributions will necessarily look like they have all the weight on this one word that has tiny probability in the real model. You can't avoid that because that could be your data.
Right. Yeah. It depends how you measure the quality, I guess.
Yeah.
Also. Is the algorithm deterministic?
The algorithm itself is not deterministic.
So this failure probability is over the random.
The failure probability is over the data and the coin tosses of the algorithm. The coin tosses, right? Not the coin tosses. Okay. I usually say the right letters, but not necessarily in the right order. So, okay, so is the model well understood now? Good. I want to mention a little bit stuff about learning mixtures. So learning mixtures, of course, is a problem that goes way back. I'm not going to detail the entire history of learning mixtures, but I think a good starting point would be Dasgupta's paper, because that was considered at the time to be a breakthrough result. So Dasgupta and many papers following his result focused on learning mixtures of Gaussians. That is sort of the most standard, let's say, model of mixture models. So this is just a mixture of K Gaussians in Rn. You have this distribution, it's a mixture. You sample points from this distribution, and then you want to infer the K Gaussians that generated this distribution. And until Dasgupta's paper was published, I think no one knew how to do this, at least with some formal proof that it actually works. And following his paper, which gave some result, it gave a result for spherical Gaussians with a rather large separation between their centers. There was a long sequence of papers that culminated a few years ago with these two results, Moitra and Valiant and Belkin and Sinha, that resolved the problem completely. So they learn an arbitrary mixture of Gaussians within statistical accuracy as you like. K here, by the way, is assumed to be a constant, and we will assume that as well. So these algorithms don't run in time, which is very good in K, as a parameter of K.
If they're separated by Ps this much, then we can separate
them.
But the query complexity is stated.
Yeah, but here, for the general case, it really runs in time, which is maybe K to the K or something like that. But the dependence on the dimension is very nice. And okay. Then there are some other models that people study. I'm not going to go into this in great detail. People know how to learn product distributions, for example, over the hypercube. So there are various results about learning product distributions over these domains. Hidden Markov chains, heavy tail distributions. So there are all sorts of distributions, K-modal distributions. There are all sorts these are mixtures of these types of distributions. People know how to learn under a certain, not going to go into the details of what they do there or what the assumptions are, but I just want you to be impressed that there are a lot of mixture models that people try to learn. So this is another one of them. I'm doing this in order to point out a significant difference between all this other work and what we're doing here. So the main issue that differs our problem from all these other mixture model problems is the issue of single view versus multi-view samples. So in the case of Gaussians, as a representative example, mixtures of Gaussians can be learned from single view samples. So each sample contains one point from the Gaussian that was chosen to generate it. And then the next point is generated perhaps using a different Gaussian. So the Gaussian is chosen again, and so forth. And you can learn Gaussians from single view samples. On the other hand, mixtures of these discrete distributions cannot be learned from single samples, because from a single sample, the only thing that you learn is that you can possibly learn is the expected probability of every word. So think of this as this represents the simplex. It should be the n simplex, but here n equals 3. And let's look at, so this represents some distribution over words, this point. Since our dictionary has only size 3, because that's the only thing I can draw on a two-dimensional slide until somebody here invents higher dimensional slides. So this is just a distribution over 3 words. You're not taking up the challenge or high dimensional slides? It sounds very useful. So, for example, I'm also going to use three documents. K is also going to be 3, because K equals 2 is boring and K equals 4 is too much. But there's no connection between the 3 here and between the n equals 3 and the k equals 3. So, for example, this expectation can be generated from these three topic distributions. But on the other hand, the same expectation can be generated from these three topic distributions. And there's no way for us to distinguish between these two cases using single view samples. And as you see, these things are pretty far, these models are pretty far apart. So I won't be able to reconstruct the model correctly from single view samples. You need to use multi-view samples. There are also some other differences that might be interesting. I'm mentioning them because you might think of them as issues that are worthy of thinking about in maybe in a more general setting. So one other important difference is the issue of how much information does a single sample point give you relative to the model size. So the model size is not something very clear here, right? We're talking about real numbers, but you can, if you have, if you represent these real numbers with limited accuracy, say accuracy 1 over polynomial in n, or actually you need 1 over, let's say, yeah, numbers that are 1 over polynomial in n, if you're learning Gaussians, the entire model can be determined by k. K is because there are k Gaussians. For each Gaussian, you need the center and the axes of the Gaussian, right? Of the ellipsoid, just the matrix. And that's about n square log n bits altogether for each Gaussian, with this accuracy of 1 over polynomial in n. And each sample point is again, if you have similar accuracy, is order n log n bits. So it's not the same size, but it's within the same ballpark. And this is typical of most learning problems. If you even think of classical pack learning problems, what you get from an individual sample is about the same ballpark information as the model that describes the phenomenon that you're observing. But in learning topic models, we need to specify k distributions within reasonable accuracy, so that's something like order k n log n bits. But in each sample point, we get only d log n bits. We get d words. Each word is specified by log n bits, because it's a word between 1 and n. And if d is constant, as we would like it to be, this is a much smaller size information. So this is, in general, an interesting question. What can we learn from very sparse information in our samples?
So just make sure. So the log n factor in topic models comes from, so the log n factor just in general comes from the fact that you want to, like, learn all the accuracy.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, yes. You could plug in the desired accuracy instead of the log n. I just thought it would be easier to understand it this way. Okay, I'll skip the last point. But I do want to mention this without getting into the details. So this entire area of learning mixture models uses a rather well-defined toolkit. So one of the tools that is used is just spectral decomposition. We look at eigenvectors corresponding to certain eigenvalues. That's one of the tools that's widely used. Another tool that is widely used is this is some form of dimension reduction, really, the spectral decomposition. You do principal component analysis, so you take the higher singular values and you look at that subspace. That's often useful. Another form of dimension reduction that is very useful is just doing random projections. Dasgupta's original paper actually uses random projections. So it reduces the dimension to k, because we only have k centers, we can reduce the dimension. And then in this small dimension, you can enumerate over things efficiently. That's sort of what he does. And the other thing that is used is what is called the method of moments. This is, in fact, what gives the final answer on the Gaussians, mostly this method of moments. And what this method of moments, or sort of it's in its very general form, is, it tells us that if we know the first few moments of the distribution, we can reconstruct all of it. And this happens to be true for mixtures of Gaussians, for example. If we know, I don't remember how many moments exactly we need, but we don't need a lot of them. Once we know those moments in sufficiently many directions, then we can reconstruct the mixture. So all we have to do is to figure out what these moments are given the sample. And in fact, if we know, so most of the error comes from the fact that we don't know these moments precisely. Okay, let's.
So you said that there's root to just reject, but why does the separation distance depend on lambda? It's like root n.
Because that was what came up with once you project, you don't want if the Gaussians collapse to if their centers collapse to be very close and they're just one on top of each other, then you can't do anything, and the distance that he could figure out from the methods that he was using after projection. Was this thing, and that was improved later. So that was just the first crude result. By now, I think the main contribution of that paper is that it generated all the following work. Because I don't think his methods are useful anymore. Okay. So back to topic models, what is the what are we trying to optimize here? So we have a learning problem, of course, so let's sample, let's wait for 100 years, sample as many documents as we can gather those 100 years, and 100 years from now, maybe we will all be dead and no one would care about this problem. So that's a wonderful algorithm. It succeeds with probability one. But we want to minimize certain parameters. So obviously we want to minimize the number of samples. I don't know, you want to classify Twitter traffic into K topics, assuming that people only talk about K topics, which makes sense. Then you would want to take as few tweets as possible in order to generate it. The other thing is we want to minimize the number of views that are required. And here again, we want to be able to classify, we want to be able to determine topic distribution from tweets rather than books. It would be much easier to determine topic distributions from encyclopedias, for example, because they have a lot of words, so they've sampled the distributions a lot. And of course we want to minimize the running time of our algorithm to make it as efficient as possible in terms of the parameters of the problem, which are m, the number of samples, d, the number of views per sample, n is the dictionary size, and k is the number of constituents in the mixture. So you can think of M and N as being very large for our purposes. Of course, there's the other problem where they're small and the other things are large, but we are considering the scenario where M and N are large and D and K are small. So D and K will be considered to be constants. And M and N are the things that we want to be asymptotically good with respect to. Now, there are some trivial bounds that we can immediately discuss. So for example, if the total number of words that we see in our entire sample, so that's m times d, right? Because there are m samples, each sample has d words. If this is a little o of n, then there are definitely models that we can't learn, because we haven't even seen words that might support a large portion of the distribution. So we can't really bound the error very well if we see too few words. So in this case, if m times d is little o of n, then there's no, we have to have at least linear sized samples in the dictionary size.
Error measure going to be
then? I haven't yet talked about it. I'll talk about it soon. But under any reasonable error that you can think of. So if we have a sample size of little o of n.
Likely the words
are so think of all the words as having roughly the same probability, say within some constant factors, and you want to learn those things, then with little o of n words sampled, you haven't seen most of the distribution yet. You've seen very little of the distribution. The entire, all the words that you collected are supporting a little o of one weight of the probability. So you definitely are not going to get something good under any reasonable measure of accuracy that you can come up with, unless your accuracy is I want to output anything, and that's good. It's a reasonable, I guess, thing that would simplify our work a lot. Now, the other extreme is the following. Suppose our the number of views is very large. Let's say it's n log n times some large constant. Then just by coupon collector or, you know, similar arguments, we've seen so a single document is gives us a very good approximation to the probability PJ that generated this particular document. And then all we have to make sure is that we have enough documents to cover all the topics. And then we can learn, so this would make the problem trivial. So of course.
You still need to figure out the
W-case. I'm sorry?
So you still have to figure out the WJs.
Yeah, so assuming that's the WJs aren't too, that would only say how many documents you need to see until you've covered all the topics. Yeah, so that would be the smallest WJ would determine, it would determine M, but it wouldn't affect anything else. M would have to be something like 1 over the smallest J, or maybe something slightly larger than that to be sure that with high probability you've encountered all topics. So this would make the problem trivial. Okay, you asked about accuracy. I'm by the way, I'm mostly presenting the problem again, so I don't know if I'll have much time to go into the proof of anything. The output of our learning algorithm are the are some distributions. This thing is meant to be tilde. That these things, except that the Mac software doesn't have tildes. Maybe PowerPoint is better. In that respect. Yeah, so I found something that you guys can brag about. So we have P1 tilde through PK tilde, and maybe also the weights. In fact, some of the algorithms don't output the weights. They only output the probabilities, and others also output the weights. And in this respect, you can think of Or people have considered two types of error, L2 error, which is just the output has L2 error epsilon if there is some permutation over the p's such that if you compare a pj prime to the matching pj, then their L2 distance is bounded by epsilon. And then other papers considered the L1 error, a similar thing, just using L1 or total variation distance between the distributions. And you should notice, of course, that this is a much stronger requirement, because L1 error epsilon implies L2 error epsilon, but L2 error epsilon only implies L1 error epsilon times root n. So in fact, this is the kind of error that we would like to get, that the total variation distance is small.
There is experimentation, because if you don't know who the WJs are, it's basically no way to distinguish between different permutations.
Even if you do, what happens if the WJs are identical? All of them are 1 over k.
Right, okay.
Then you don't know the permutation, right. But there is some permutation for which this would be true. Okay, I want to explain what's known. And this is what we need for that. Yeah, that doesn't look too promising. It's a lot of notation, but I need that in order to explain the bounds that are. So it's not that difficult. Let's go over it very slowly. First of all, we'll denote by P the constituents matrix. So that's the matrix whose columns are the P1 through PK. So this is a matrix that has n rows and k columns. And mu will be the mean, so that's just the sum of wj, pj. That denotes the expected probability of all the words. And m, the matrix m, is the matrix of, it's the pairwise distribution matrix. So this would be the distribution of documents that contain two words. If I would generate from this mixture a sequence, an infinite sequence of documents, each one contains two words, then Mij would be the probability that the pair of words ij appeared in a document. This is the distribution. And then we'll denote by V. V will be sort of a variance. So it will be M minus mu mu transpose. Mu mu transpose would be the pairwise distribution if all the documents were generated from this mean distribution mu. So this denotes this high dimensional variance. It's a variance matrix. V. It's the difference between the pairwise distribution in our mixture and the pairwise distribution had we replaced the mixture by its mean. Now we have these linear algebra notation for matrices. So sigma I would be the ith largest singular value on the left. And lambda I would be the largest eigenvalue. So this assumes the matrix is symmetric, lambda notation. And the condition number is the ratio between the largest singular value of a matrix and the smallest non-zero singular value of a matrix. And finally, we'll define a spreading parameter. So the spreading parameter is intended to capture the fact that we need some, that these PIs need to be distinct in some sense. If they're all the same, then obviously I'm not going to generate k different distributions. And if they're very close together, distinguishing between them requires more effort. And this is captured by this zeta spreading parameter, which is the minimum between two specific parameters. One of them essentially captures, so it's written in this way, but it essentially captures it's the minimum total variation distance between two constituent distributions, really. It's written here in terms of L2 for various reasons, but that's what it tries to capture.
It's really important for you to separate them if they're really, really close. I mean, can't you just do the permutation
still be? Ideally, we would like to do that, but we don't know how to. I mean, none of the results really knows how to do it.
they all rely in one way or the other on knowing something about the separation. So some of them, for example, would work for any separation except that you need to know what separation it is, and you have to work harder in order to achieve this. But you're right. Ideally, you would just want to generate a model that is statistically close to the correct model. And if there are two constituents that are very close apart and you don't have a good enough sample, you should be able to replace them by just one constituent that would... So unfortunately, we don't know how to do that. And then zeta 2 is just, it's really the width of this collection of points in every direction where they have a width different than zero. So they're spread somehow in space, in the simplex, in the n minus 1 simplex. And they, of course, they're k points, so they lie on a k flat. So in every direction in this k flat, zeta 2 is the minimum width in every of the set of points in every direction of the k-flat. Okay, so now we can say what is known. The first result that I want to mention is by Anant Kumar et al. It has certain assumptions, or it has one big assumption, which is P, right? That's the constituents matrix is full dimensional. So this means, for example, that our constituents don't lie on a line, for example, in the simplex or on any flat that is has dimension smaller than k minus 1. K minus 1. K minus 1 or k? K minus 1. It has affine dimension k. In this case, so this turns out to be a very strong assumption because in this case, all you need is documents that have three words. Once you have documents that have three words, of course, if they're longer, you can just split them. Then you can learn the model, except that this algorithm actually uses a pretty large sample size. So it learns the model with L2 error, not L1 error. This is the L2 error that it achieves, and this is the sample size that it achieves. So you should think of these singular values and eigenvalues as being something which is about 1 over n, just to get in the worst case. Of course, there could be constituents P for which these are very small, for which these are very large, and then that's good for us. But in the worst case, you could have a well-separated instance where all the entries are, say, between 1 over n and 2 over n, or between, say, a half over n and 2 over n. And then these numbers will be very small. They will be 1 over n. So this gives us a sample size which is polynomial in n and in epsilon squared. But on the other hand, it's also polynomial in k. So the behavior with respect to k here is very good.
So what is C?
C is some constant. I didn't want to specify it precisely. Partly because I don't remember what it is. So they gave two algorithms that do this. Then this is our result. In comparison. We make no assumption, so we don't make this full rank assumption. But unfortunately, once you don't make the full rank assumption, you must assume that you have larger documents. So we assume that the documents have 2k minus 1 words. And in fact, this is necessary if you assume a general mixture. The example is very simple. You can, so this is an illustration of the example. Think of a line passing through the simplex, and think of your mixture constituents as being points on this line. It turns out that you can find two different configurations of points on the line that have exactly the same first 2k minus 2 moments. And if you sample only 2k minus 2 words in each document, you can't get any information beyond the first 2k minus 2 moments. So in fact, these two different examples, you just shift these things a bit. Not a bit, but overall they're shifted by a lot. And you get two examples that have exactly the same sample distribution over documents that have size 2k minus 2. So you need at least 2k minus 1 words in order to get any difference between these two far apart models. And we can actually learn once you hit that size document. We get an L1 error as opposed to the L2 error there. And this is the sample size. So you see that, first of all, in terms of the dependence on N, the sample size is close to the best that we can, because we know we need linear sample, and this is N polylog N in terms of N alone. In terms of K, on the other hand, we have this additive factor, which is exponential in some horrible things, k square log k, essentially. Now, what's interesting here also is that suppose k is very small compared to n, then this would be the dominant part. But this part, this size sample, we only need documents of size 2. And beyond that, we need only this many documents of size 2k minus 1. So you could learn from a lot of very small documents and a few very large ones, except that the few very large ones is something exponential or worse in k. So you see the comparison to the previous work. The dependence on n here is much better. This would be the two algorithms if we want L1 error instead of L2 error, if we translate their L2 error into L1 error. The first algorithm is about n to the eighth. The second one is n cubed. With a sample size of n cubed, they're looking at three word documents. You get pretty accurate statistics on at least the more common words among all the triples. So you get pretty accurate statistics about on the distribution of documents. So the entire problem that they have is to reconstruct the model from exact statistics, basically, because they get very good statistics. On the other hand, in our case, we get very poor statistics on the document distribution. We only have n polylog n documents. So the statistics on documents, even of size 2, is not very accurate, and still we're able to learn. But on the other hand, they have their dependence on K is polynomial, and here the dependence is really bad.
These two are the algorithms in AHK.
Mm-hmm. And you still need the assumption that You still need the, in AHK, they still need this assumption that the matrix is full. Linearly.
Yeah, they need this assumption that the, yeah, so there is this other thing. Okay, it's 4:28, so when do I stop?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay, so I'll skip any notion of algorithm. This is what the algorithm does, but let's skip this. We won't have, I want to talk a little bit about mixed topic models. So we talked about pure topic models. Pure topic models are those where each document is generated from a single topic. In the mixed topic model, each document is a mixture of topics. So it's not just one topic. It's not talking about one thing. It's talking about many different things, or some different things. And in order to, so here's the model. Again, in order to generate a D word document, we simply draw D independent samples from some distribution P. This is exactly the same as the pure documents model, except that now the distribution P will be chosen in a more complicated way. So we still have K topics, K distributions, P1 through PK. But we also have a probability measure theta on the convex hull of P1 through PK. So the convex hull is just some convex set inside the simplex. And in order to generate a document, we choose a distribution P in the convex hull of these pure topic distributions according to the probability measure theta. And then we sample from this distribution P. So this is the model. And now one example of theta that people talk about a lot is this latent Dirichlet allocation. Other than saying the words, I don't know much about it. So it's some specific class of distributions that has nice properties. That's as much as I can say about it. Maybe some other people can say more. Okay. So what's known about the mixed topic model? One thing that's known is this old result of ours that was never published. Well, I think it's on the archive, but that's it. That essentially completely solves the problem, except that we can only do it when the number of topics is 2. So if there are 2 topics and there's an arbitrary distribution on convex combinations of these 2 topics, then we can reconstruct the entire model, including the distribution on the convex hull of these topics that generated the documents. And I have to explain what guarantees we actually get. So we basically have 2 topics. So that defines a segment in the simplex. And we have some arbitrary distribution on the segment. And what we're reconstructing is this distribution on the segment, and the segment itself, of course. So the segment could be slightly inaccurate, and the distribution on the segment could be slightly inaccurate. And what we can guarantee is that with high probability, the transportation cost between the model that we generate and the true model is very small. But here the error depends on the document size. So the bigger the documents, the better error we get. And in fact, let me go back. In fact, this turns out to be necessary. So without further assumptions, if for example, you know that that your distribution on this convex hull comes from a latent Dirichlet model, then perhaps you can do better. In fact, it's known that you can do it better. But if it doesn't, if it's an arbitrary distribution, then you can't get an error better than this. So there are always 2 distributions that are far apart, that are this far apart in transportation norm, that generate exactly the same D-word distribution. So you won't be able to distinguish. This is an issue even if you have a perfect statistics on your documents, you would not be able to distinguish between the 2 models. Okay, so here is the transportation cost. It's how much mass I need to. It's the product of the mass that I need to transfer and the distance that it needs to travel. That's basically what it is. I have some probability in the simplex over an interval, and I have the true probability over maybe a slightly different interval. And in order to translate one distribution to the other, I need to transfer mass along certain distances, and the minimum cost of doing this is the transportation cost. So that's what we can show. This is just an illustration of transportation cost between two distributions. It's moving this mass here. How can you do it in the most efficient way where your cost of moving a quantum of mass is the distance it travels? Yeah, exactly. Yes. Then finally, I guess I'm nearing the end. So I should mention this result of Aurora et al. They learn various things. So they make pretty strong assumptions on the model. They assume that the distributions are rho separable. And rho separable means that each distribution has one unique entry that that appears with probability zero in the other distributions, and in this distribution appears with high probability, at least rho. Rho, think of it as a constant. So every topic has one word that identifies it singularly. And they can learn this thing with L infinity error epsilon, which means L1 error epsilon times n. And sometimes, so they can learn this for essentially arbitrary thetas. So this is a mixed document. They learn the p's. In some cases, they can also learn the theta itself. One of the cases that they can learn is this latent Dirichlet allocation. But in general, they don't reconstruct the theta. It's only in very special cases. And this is their sample size. So you should think of this as, this will also be something polynomial in n. But the dependence on k is also only polynomial. Okay, finally, there is this result that shows that specifically for the Dirichlet allocation model, the latent Dirichlet allocation model, if p is full rank, the thing is full rank, then it's sufficient to have aperture D, and you get some. So in this specific case, you get basically a better result than this. And finally, I guess some open problems. That's the highlight of the talk, I guess, since I didn't give any algorithms. I think the most important question here, and there might be some indication that the answer to this question is negative, it can't be done, is to do the best of both worlds. So to get a learning algorithm that is both, say, nearly linear in n, maybe n polylog n, and also polynomial in k, the sample size. We have one or the other. We have nearly linear in n, and we have polynomial in k, but not both of them together. The other obvious question is can we, in the mixed documents model, can we recover an arbitrary theta without any assumptions? So Arora et al. Know how to recover theta, and also the other paper know how to recover theta in the case of latent Dirichlet allocation, but not in the case of a general distribution on the convex hull of P1 through PK. I believe this can be done. And related to this is the following question. So, in fact, our result specifically uses a method of moments. All of these results, in one way or the other, use a method of moments. They show that the distribution can be inferred from small moments of the distribution. But we have to use one-dimensional moment. So in some sense, we're projecting. We're not really projecting because we don't know the data, but we are generating the sample distribution of the projections of the p's onto lines in order to reconstruct the model. And this uses a method of a one-dimensional method of moments. So it would be nice to do this directly in the k-dimensional flat, which is, by the way, fairly easy to reconstruct because that comes from spectral decomposition. To get this k-dimensional flat, you can look at the pairwise correlation matrix M, from which you derive this variance matrix V, and just doing taking the doing singular value decomposition and taking the k highest components would essentially give you the flat. Can you come up with a method of moments that works in this k-dimensional flat directly rather than having to pick lines there and project the points? This might be useful for Gaussians as well, because there's this problem there too. That people use one-dimensional methods of moments, and they have to project eventually the stuff onto lines. So that's it.
Any more questions? Any non-trivial lower bounds that you have, like except for just the single tangent?
I don't have any lower bounds. Well, I'm not aware of lower bounds. So what do you want to lower bound? Certain lower bounds we do have, for example, on the document size. So we know that in general, say 2k minus 1 words are necessary in order to learn the pure documents model in general, without any further assumptions. Mm-hmm. That's a lower bound. But a lower bound on the sample size.
But it's something that depends on.
Parameters of each. Yeah. So this is sort of that question, right? Can we get this bound? We don't know.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah. Maybe the question is like, did you tell us all the lower bounds that I know? You might.
You all the ones that I was aware of when I wrote the slides.
Okay.
Are they the same as the ones I'm aware of right now? I'm not sure. So, might be Ankur Moitra. Someone told me that they think that this is probably not achievable, but not that they have the proof that it's not achievable. So I don't know, maybe I wouldn't take that as. The same problem, by the way, you could ask about Gaussian. So the Gaussian learning, there I think maybe people do know. It also depends exponentially on k, or even worse, I think it's k to the k. Mm-hmm. That would be an even more natural question to ask. Is that a lower bound? And that might be necessary in general.
Mm-hmm. So those results are the optimal with respect to the separation, but okay, the sample sizes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Without strong assumptions, I think. Anyway, I'm not aware of lower bounds here. Okay.